Paul.
Adam.
Having a good to meet you, Adam.
Nice to meet you, too.
Welcome. All right. Okay, welcome to Central Parkway Baptist Church. The first Sunday in April. We're about a week in, but this is our first Sunday, and the weather's been absolutely beautiful. I hope that you're spending some time outside enjoying it. Lots going on in the life of our church, and so just to go over that, particularly next week is pretty busy. As per usual on the second Sunday, the men are having a prayer breakfast over at the Denny's on I Drive at 9 o'clock. And there's also a rummage sale going on at the church, okay? So if you have, I think there's still availability, if you have some items around the house that you'd like to sell and you need maybe to save up a little money or make a little money, you could rent a table and sell your stuff, do some spring cleaning. So if you call Scott Steinfeld at that number and reserve a table or two, he'll set you up. And then it's next Saturday from 9 to 3. And an opportunity also to meet some folks. This has been advertised, so there's going to be folks renting tables from the community. A wonderful opportunity next Saturday from 9 to 3, so feel free to stop in. Okay. Also next week, after our second service, is a kickoff meeting for our Vacation Bible School ministry. If you would like to volunteer in any capacity, come and find out what Vacation Bible School is all about this year. And it's launching June 2nd through the 6th. T-shirts are $10. You could support Vacation Bible School by buying a T-shirt. And the last day to order is May 12th. And then following the service, don't rush off, particularly if you're a member of Central Parkway Baptist Church. We're voting on an amendment to the budget, which we've discussed a couple weeks ago. And so today's it's just a quick ballot vote for or against this amendment to the budget. Okay? All right. Let's continue to worship the Lord in song.
Good morning. Good morning. Praise God for this beautiful day that He's given us. Please stand if you're able, and let's worship the Lord together. Thank you.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Praise God. Praise God. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we lift your name on high. Lord, you are worthy of all of our praise, Father, worthy of all the glory. Father, as we continue singing worship and praise to you, Lord, I pray that it is acceptable to you, Lord, and we give you our best. Father, thank you for allowing us to be here. and to serve you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Unto the King Eternal, unto the reigning King, unto the Lord Almighty, praises I will sing to the King Eternal, sing to the King of Kings, sing to declare His glory, let His praises ring. I will lift my hands in joy before the King, I lift my hands in praise, I lift my heart in joyful jubilation, I lift my voice in praise, and I will shout blessing to the King, and I will shout glory to the King, and I will shout honor to the King, and I will shout power to the King, declaring blessing and glory and honor and power belong to Jesus the King of Kings. Now unto the King Eternal, unto the reigning King, unto the Lord Almighty, praises I will sing to the King Eternal, sing to the King of Kings, sing to declare His glory, let His praises ring.
I will lift my hands in joy before my King, I lift my hands I lift my heart in joyful jubilation. I lift my voice in praise. And I will shout blessing to the King. And I will shout glory to the King. And I will shout honor to the King. And I will shout power to the King. Declaring blessing and glory and honor and power belong to Jesus the King of Kings. Now unto the King Eternal, unto the reigning King, unto the Lord Almighty, praises I will sing to the King Eternal, sing to the King of Kings, sing to declare His glory, let His praises ring, let His praises ring.
Amen. Amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. You may be seated.
Good morning, church. What an awesome day to be in the Lord's house. Just a quick reminder, what Pastor Paul was saying, next Sunday, following the 11 o'clock service, Vacation Bible School meeting in the Fellowship Hall, if you're interested in helping with teaching or helping anything like that, please come and join us. T-shirts are on sale between now until, I think it's May the 12th. We get those custom made, so we got to have a couple weeks to get them printed, so just see us. I mean, 10 bucks. Literally, we make zero money on it, but I don't do it as a profit thing. I do it because we can get our own shirts, because those same shirts going through Lifeway are like 18 bucks a piece. I'm like, that's crazy. I can get them made for 10, so we're good. So, throughout the entire Bible, Genesis to Revelation, God tells and encourages His church, His people, to take the gospel to all corners of the earth. We are challenged to do that. In Sunday school today, we talked about Acts 9, where it says, all Judea, Galilee, and Samaria. So what I like to do is take it and simplify it. So it's Orlando, to the state of Florida, to the United States, and then to the entire world. We have to start at home. Our missionary today is doing the exact same thing. Stephen and Lisa Shaw in Broken Arrow, Oklahoma, started a little church. They began to witness to their neighbors, to their friends. They began to sharing ministries, going to where the people in need are. Then as they grew, they then took the word to Peru, using their skills and their medical teaching and training in that way. doing what God has us to do, where He has us to do it. But we have to trust in Him. How do we know where to go? How do we know what to talk to? We all start with prayer. Having that conversation with God. Allowing Him to guide you. So we'll take a few moments. We're going to bow our heads. Pray for those missionaries that are out there serving. Continue to pray for peace in Jerusalem. Continue to pray for peace within the United States of America. Pray for what God is doing in your life, in your heart. Let's take a few moments to bow our heads, and I'll come back and close this shortly. Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank You. Lord, we thank You for this moment in this day that You have created. Lord, You have brought us together as one family today, Lord. Lord, thank You for never giving up on us, Lord. Lord, we deserve death. We deserve the punishment for our sin. But Lord, through Your grace, through Your mercy, through Your love, and through the greatest gift of Your Son on that cross, our sins can be atoned for. Lord, we thank You for that, Lord. Lord, I thank You for missionaries that go out and serve. They serve in their community, in their state, and they're going around this world to share the glorious good news of You, Lord, to each and every one, Lord. Lord, we pray for them. Lord, we pray for peace in Jerusalem. We pray for peace in the United States. Lord, that the leaders have tried to accomplish their own personal goals. They have failed again. Lord, I ask, Lord, that Your hand be upon Jerusalem or upon the United States. Lord, and just come and bring peace, Your peace. Lord, we pray for healing. Lord, I pray for each one that's sitting in this room right now. Lord, You know each heart. You know each mind. Lord, the challenges. Lord, I just ask that Your loving embrace will be around each one. And Lord, as we continue to sing, we continue to praise, we thank You for this opportunity. In Your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Please stand if you're able, and let's worship with our third song. Thank you.
That You are mindful of. true that you are thinking of me. How you love me. It's amazing. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. God
gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you. We thank you for this opportunity to give back to you a small portion of what you've so graciously given. Lord, bless the gift and the giver. In your Son's name, amen.
our text this morning, Jesus walks through walls, but I don't walk through microphones, so I'm just going to move this, avoid any collision. I'll invite you to turn in your copy of God's Word to John, the Gospel of John chapter 20, and we'll be looking today at verses 19 through 29. John, the Gospel of John chapter 20, verses 19 through 29. Before we get started, I want to wish a happy birthday to my mother-in-law and a happy 51st anniversary to my mother and father-in-law today. So they're here in Orlando celebrating. No better place to be celebrating an anniversary than Orlando, and we're happy to have them with us this week. So turning your attention to God's Word, John chapter 20, verses 19 through 29. The word of the Lord. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." May the Lord bless the reading of his word to our hearts and our minds for understanding, but also our hands as we seek to not only be hearers, but doers of God's word. So last week, we noted at the beginning of this chapter in Scripture that when John describes a time of day, he is not only describing a time of day, but also the spiritual condition of the people in the story that he's about to tell, right? So Nicodemus came to Jesus at night and did not understand what Jesus was telling him when he said, "You must be born again." Nicodemus was in ignorance. The woman at the well in the very next chapter, John 4, came to him at noon, and she was able to decipher that Jesus was indeed the Messiah. So the day was as bright as could be, and the woman had an understanding of the identity of Jesus. Judas Iscariot did his dastardly deed of betraying our Lord to the hands of the religious leadership at night, John says. Last week, Mary Magdalene came in the morning, yet it was still dark. So we noted that John is trying to say that this is a time of transition, right? That this woman is about to be changed from darkness to light. She's going to have an illumination. She's going to be enlightened. She's going to see the Lord. And so we have here today an account of the resurrection of our Lord amongst his disciples in the very same chapter. But this is happening, the Bible says, in verse 19, on the evening of that day. Again, a transition time. Again, telling us something about what's going to happen to the people in the story, right? Evening. It's not daytime anymore. It's not fully nighttime. It's the hours leading up to night, but it's not dark. And that's the condition of the disciples. He continues saying that they are in a room. The door is closed, and not only is the door closed, they're behind closed doors, they're behind locked doors. Why? The Bible says that they're in fear. They fear for their very life. They're protecting themselves. They're afraid specifically of the same leadership that had Jesus crucified. So 3 days earlier, they witnessed a traumatic death. They witnessed their Lord that they had followed for these 3 years, crucified, beaten, mocked. And they were afraid that they were going to be guilty by association. This is the fight or flight response. And they've added one today, fight, flight, or freeze, right? This is physiological. This is the body protecting itself from harm, from danger. We really can't do anything about it. We're born that way. So Peter is afraid when they come to betray Jesus, when the guard of the high priest comes with torches and swords, and he's afraid. And what's Peter's initial response? I'm going to fight. And without even thinking, he grabs his sword and tries to slash the ear of the servant of the high priest. And when he sees that Jesus isn't into that, he's afraid. And what does he do? Along with all the others, flight, right? They run away. They're afraid for their life. It's natural. It's biological. And here, even 3 days later, they're frozen in fear. They don't want to fall under the same fate that befell the Lord. But I believe we're seeing here in the Gospel of John that fear is not merely a temporary biological life preservation response, which it is, but it also appears to be an indication of their general spiritual outlook on life. Of course, the word door here could be taken literally. They were in a room and it had a literal door. And the word locked also as well. It was locked, it was bolted, it was sealed off somehow, hoping that no one would come in. But these same words could also be taken figuratively or more than literal. Jesus says in the Revelation, which was written by John, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and eat with him, and he with me." Jesus here, of course, is not referring to a physical door. He's knocking at the door of the heart of the believer, at the heart of the church, desiring a renewed and a refreshed fellowship. There's not a door. He's knocking at the door of your heart. Also in Acts chapter 14, "And when they arrived and gathered the church together, they declared all that God had done with them and how he had opened a door of faith to the Gentiles." And so the report here is not that the Gentiles were actually going through a physical door. It was that they proclaimed the gospel and a door of faith, a faith that they didn't have before. Now they had faith, so a door of their faith was open. And so door is a literal door, but it's also a spiritual door. It's your heart. Likewise, the word locked could have the connotation of closing one's heart against somebody. 1 John 3:17, "But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against them, how does God's love abide in him?" Right? So there, the closing, our unwillingness to help somebody in need is a closing. It's a locking of the heart towards that person. Our attitudes and actions could lock ourselves and others out of the kingdom of God. Matthew 23:13. But woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut the kingdom of heaven in people's faces, for you neither enter yourselves nor allow those who would enter to go in. So Jesus in Matthew is saying that the Pharisees and the scribes were locking the door of heaven through their attitude, through their behavior, through their general way of being. They were keeping people out of heaven. Not a physical door, not a literal lock, but their attitudes, their actions were the lock that were shutting people out from the kingdom of God. So here we see in John chapter 20, the disciples were seeing their spiritual condition, their spiritual temperature, right? We're seeing that they're in fear. And when we live in fear, we're closed off to the rest of the world. We're in preservation mode, right? We're locked away. And for good reason. We were hurt. We don't want to be hurt further. We were disappointed. We don't want to be disappointed anymore. So by huddling together and locking them out, we don't have to face them. We don't have to deal with them. They can't hurt us in here. We're safe in here. And so, because of fear, and in an effort to preserve their life, they're closing off their hearts to others, particularly here to the Jewish leadership. So this reminds me so much of when Jesus says, he says it in Matthew and he says it in Luke, if you try to save your life or preserve your life, you're actually doing what? You're losing your life. And when you lose your life, you're gaining your life. And so here we see an instance of these disciples, because of fear, they're preserving their life, but what kind of life are they preserving? A life of fear, a life of worry, a life of anxiety, a life that's closed off to the world. Because they were afraid. That's what fear does. Fear closes our hearts to the world. We lock out the world because we're afraid. And because of what they've gone through, you really can't blame them. A lot of it is biological, physical, psychological, and of course, spiritual. But we have good news, and the good news is that Jesus, the resurrected Lord, is not bound by locked doors or closed hearts. He shows up right in the middle of them, right amongst them, while they're afraid, in their state of disillusionment, in their fear, in their anxiety, in their worry. Christ shows up. And what does he say? Just like he commanded the raging sea, when he rebuked it and he said, be still, be quiet. He said to those raging hearts, those worried hearts, those anxious disciples, peace, peace, peace be with you. Now you can imagine, right, if you're thinking about these guys huddled up, closed hearts, locked hearts, worried, fearful, what's their body saying? Right? What's their posture? Whether they're sitting down or standing up, what do they look like? In your mind's eye, use your sanctified imagination and paint yourself a picture of what these fellows look like in this room. Are they standing like this, smiling, laughing, you know, throwing their arms around each other, you know, toasting? What are they doing? Probably, I think they're hunched over, right? I think their brows are their brows are furrowed, right? I think they're sad, and I think if we were to walk in that room, you could feel it. Don't have you ever been in a room where you could feel the tension, feel the sadness? Walking into a funeral, sometimes, you know, a wake or a viewing, you just sense the heaviness. But then look. Look what verse 20 says. When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. They were glad. Their mourning turned to gladness. And so when they realized who was there amongst them, in their midst, they went from being slouched over and sad and maybe weepy and just heavy to standing and being boldened and glee and joy was, happiness was on their face. They were glad when they saw the Lord. They went from being afraid to being glad. And again, Jesus proclaims peace. But this time he does something a little strange to our hearing, to our seeing. What does he do? He breathes on them. He breathes on them. And this takes us way back to Genesis, right? When God formed man from the dust of the ground and he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul, nephesh, a living being, a complete whole person. And Jesus is taking these fearful, worried, dying men and breathing into them new life and giving them a pattern, giving them a mission, giving them a purpose. He sends them out. He said, you can't stay behind these locked doors anymore. Get out. As the Father, don't just get out. Don't just leave. He's not saying get over it. He's not saying stop crying. He's not saying just stop being afraid. He's saying, as the Father has sent me, so I am sending you. In the same pattern in which God is sending me or sent me, so now I am sending you. Now, you could imagine if this didn't happen, right? You could imagine a scenario in which Jesus didn't resurrect. They were following a wise teacher for 3 years, and this happened, and now they're sad, they're afraid for their own lives, but eventually they got to move on. Eventually, they can't stay in this locked room forever, so maybe some of them go to become fishermen again, others maybe Matthew takes up his tax business again. I don't know. They go about and they do something, but their lives are ever marked by this trauma, marked by this sadness, marked by this fear that the world is wild and dangerous, and there's really not a whole lot we could do about it but be afraid. But Jesus says, as the Father sent me, so I am sending you. And then what does he tell them to do? What does he say? Do you remember? What does he say? Oh, come on now. You're waiting with bated breath. What did Jesus say? As the Father has sent me, so I am sending you. What does he say? And then what he says, if you forgive the sins of anyone, they are forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness from anyone, it is withheld. What does this have to do with what's going on? Who do they need to forgive? Why do they need to leave and go and be sent? And the command is to forgive. Well, you could imagine they can't go in the pattern. They can't go in the way of Jesus unless they go with the first, the qualifier of their task, their job is to go and forgive. First and foremost, like Jesus, they need to forgive those that crucified Christ. Their life pattern has to be a pattern of forgiveness. That's the only way that they could become unafraid and walk out the door. Because listen, if none of this had happened, if Jesus didn't rise from the dead, they have every right to huddle up and to be afraid and preserve as whatever life they can and to protect themselves in whatever way they can. But if Jesus is sending them, and if the pattern in which Jesus sent them is the pattern in which Jesus sent God, God sent Jesus, excuse me, and if the result of that sending is the resurrection, then even though, and listen, we're not candy coating anything here. right? Jesus was crucified. Jesus was killed. Scary things happen in this world. The world is not tamed. The world is wild. The world is not predictable. The world is very much unpredictable. Safety is nowhere guaranteed. People could be very mean and brutal and harsh. That is the world. But Jesus is saying, you're going to go out. I'm sending you into that world. And what I'm sending you out into that world is to go out and forgive that world. Let that be the first thing out of your mouth. And before it's even out of your mouth, let that be the attitude of your heart. That's kind of strange, but I think what's happening here is before you meet anybody, you need to establish in your heart that you've already forgiven that person. Because it's likely that they're going to do something to offend you in your relationship with them. It's likely that they're going to do something or be a way that you don't like. It's likely that they're going to offend you. And what Jesus is saying, if you're going to go out in the same pattern in which God has sent me, your attitude and your disposition has to be that of forgiving before they ever ask for it. You've already offered it to them. Now, when you meet somebody for the first time, don't say, I forgive you. That's just weird. They're going to look at you funny. And that's not what I'm saying that you should do. But in your heart, listen, in your heart, you have an understanding of the world as a broken place. In your heart, you have the understanding that the world is not safe. It's wild. But our weapons for taming it? Our weapons for blessing it? Even our weapons for changing it are not the weapons of the world. It's the fruit of the Holy Spirit. It's love and joy and peace and patience and goodness and kindness and gentleness and self-control. It's offering forgiveness before it's ever asked, because we're not afraid of the dangerous world, because as Christ lives, so we will live also. Living out of the truth of forgiveness beforehand. It pays love back with hate, love back for violence. There's no guarantee of safety and security, but life in the Spirit means that I am forgiving the world on this beforehand and facing the world with an open heart of love, because that is the only way that love could spread and grow. So then we move from the disciples in general and they're being afraid to them experience the resurrection as a group to then to just the one, to Thomas. And at first it bothered me in verse 26. Thomas wasn't there when this happened, but now 8 days later he's there and the doors again are locked. As we get to verse 26, we see that the disciples are together. The doors are still locked. I don't think that's because there was it wasn't a genuine experience for the other disciples. I just believe that Thomas was there, and Thomas was sure that he wouldn't believe, even though his friends kept on telling him, "We've seen the Lord. We've seen the Lord." He said, "I have not seen unless I see the Lord. Unless I put my fingers in the wounds, I cannot and will not believe." So Thomas's heart at this point is still closed. And we can't blame him. Again, he's grieving. And by the way, everybody grieves differently. He wasn't there with the others. It's because he needed his way, his time, his space to process the grief that he was experiencing. Thomas's first words recorded to our Lord is in John chapter 11, verse 16. Thomas, called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us go that we may die with him." Thomas said that. Jesus says, "We got to go to Jerusalem." His disciple says, "We can't go to Jerusalem. Something's going to happen to us if we go to Jerusalem." And Thomas said, "Well, if he's going to die, we're going to die with him." That's a bold, fresh faith. He was ready to go. Then Then in John chapter 14, verse 5, we have more words of Thomas recorded. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how could we know the way? Jesus says difficult things. Jesus says things that are hard to understand. And have you ever been in class when the teacher says something and you don't understand it, but you don't want to feel dumb or like you're the only one that doesn't get it, so you don't raise your hand? Thomas, he said, I don't care if I look stupid. I'm raising my hand. Jesus, we don't know where you're going, so how could we know the way? You could say he was ignorant. I say he was growing. He was asking the tough questions. But then you have this trauma. Then you have this difficulty. Then you have this crucifixion situation happen. And he says, in no way will I believe that he's alive. Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails and place my finger into the mark of his nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe. Jesus tells him, stop becoming an unbeliever. And the last words we have recorded from Thomas in the gospel is, Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. That's the strongest declaration of the deity of Christ in all the gospels. Came from this poor guy that we've labeled as the doubter. His name should be the believer. His name should be the witness. Because at last he saw the Lord and his faith was grounded in the resurrected Lord. Now again, I think this is a literary device that John is using, particularly in this part of the gospel, because John's concern throughout the entire gospel hasn't so much been the disciples or getting the story exactly right like all the other gospels. John's intent the entire time has been, what is your response to what's being witnessed? What's your response to the testimony, right? The whole way through in the Gospel of John, he's concerned about you. He writes Jesus' prayer in John 17:20. I do not ask for these only, but for those who will believe in me through their word. Right here in John chapter 20, 28, when he says to Thomas in verse 29, Jesus said to him, have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. He's talking about us. And then in verse 30 and 31, the gospel writer says, now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. So the question is, based on the witness of the disciples and based on your own living experience, have you believed? Or I shall ask, are you believing in his name? Life is still just as messed up. Life is still just as crazy, just as dangerous. Things change at a rapid pace. This is not the world that you grew up in, right? All of that. We could say all those things. It seems to be getting worse, right? The violence seems to be getting worse. The ideology seems to be spreading. Everything seems to be bad. Is your heart closed and locked because of the bad news of this world? Are you paying more attention to the Fox News than you are to the good news of Jesus' living, resurrected, appointed life that he's told you to not be afraid of the world? To not be afraid of immigration, to not be afraid of who's going to be the president in the next year, to not live in such fear, but to go out from this place pre-forgiving and loving, because your position in Christ is that of eternal life in the resurrection. If he lives, does he live? Does Jesus live? Does Jesus live? Listen, if Jesus lives, then you shall live also. And our weapons for this world that's in such dismay, our weapons for this world that seems to be broken and going downhill and in a spiral or whatever else you want to say about it, it's all true. But our Our weapons are, listen, forgive. Our weapons are our love. Our weapons are our peace. Not the weapons of the world. Not the strategy of the world. They have other strategies. They have other weapons. And it's going to continue on in a spiral. But Jesus came that we might have life and have it abundantly. And being hidden away, closed off, scared hearts in fear is not life. It might be the preservation of some it's not life. Jesus came that you might have life and have it abundantly. Listen, it's easy to say to somebody, you need Jesus. I'm washing my hands with you. You need Jesus. I can't do anything for you. You need Jesus. Except that Jesus doesn't tell us just to do that. Jesus says, I'm sending you just as the Father has sent me. Go and forgive. You need to forgive. Jesus will forgive them. That's unquestioned. The question is, are you forgiving? And that's what the command is from our Lord. Let's pray. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time and your word and the reality of the resurrection, not only as a historical event, but as a living reality in our life today. And like Thomas, our faith fluctuates. There's times when we want to go and die with him, and then there's times when we don't understand what Jesus is saying, and there's even times when we're tempted to disbelieve, to not believe, and to become like an unbeliever. Father, we're made new, we're reborn in the power of the Holy Spirit, and we've been given a commission, an invitation, that our front-facing reality to the world is not one of fear, but one of love, of forgiveness. Sometimes, God, that means breaking the binds of biology and everything that's naturally pushing against us to live this way. But, Father, by the power of your Spirit, we are more than conquerors. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Church, we're going to transition into the time of it's the first Sunday we're going to share the Lord's table together. And so I'm going to call those that are going to help to distribute it, our deacons, to come forward. It's all good. It's kind of strange. Okay. The Apostle Paul gives us the order for the memorial service of the Lord's Supper in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. He says, I received from the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. On the night he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and after having given thanks, said, take, eat, this is my body, which is for you. In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this every time you drink of it in memory of me. And then at the end, he says, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. So this is our preaching together of our common faith in our Lord and his sacrificial death as an atonement for our sins. We're going to give thanks for the bread and for the cup as Deacon Paul Carlin leads us in prayer.
Summer, the warm.
you haven't already done so, you could remove that top cellophane. The Lord Jesus said, "Take, eat, this is my body. Eat of it, all of you." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this every time you drink of it in memory of me." Drink of it, all of you. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Now, just a couple of instructions before we dismiss. One is, this is the first Sunday of the month, and we participate in a voluntary benevolence offering, which goes to help church members in times of financial crisis. If you're willing and able to participate in that, there will be some deacons at the door to lead in that effort. And also, if you're a member of Central Parkway Baptist Church, just stay behind for a couple more moments, because we're going to do this ballot voting for the amendment of the 2024 budget. If you're not a member of Central Parkway Baptist Church and you'd like to learn more about how to become a member of Central Parkway Baptist Church, I'd love to have that conversation with you at your earliest convenience. Just get a hold of me. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you, cause his face to shine upon you, be gracious to you, lift up his countenance upon you, and give you peace. We'll see you again real soon. God bless you.